Penguin Random House Audio presents Everything Beautiful, A Guide to Finding Hidden Beauty in the World by Ella Frances Sanders. Read for you by Subhadra Newton. Note to listeners, this program includes a downloadable PDF that contains illustrations and quotes from the book. Beauty does not reserve itself for special elite moments or instances. It does not wait for perfection, but is present already, secretly, in everything. John O. Donahue. The truly precious things are those which form ladders reaching towards the beauty of the world, openings onto it. Simone Weil. One definition of beauty. A sort of lighthouse, somewhere to start. Bahar Orang. Introduction. These days, most of us are either constantly overwhelmed or getting very close to being constantly overwhelmed. And for those who do not feel overwhelmed in the slightest, there is usually a price being paid somewhere else. We are sent into spins of fear and feeling by all the things we need to get done, by the consequences of not doing those things, by the lack of time we have to process the deep and difficult happenings both in our close world and in the worlds of others, with the internet propelling us day in and day out toward noise and comparison and numbness. When the world feels unbearably large and largely out of control, what I've found is that there is almost always reassurance and meaning to be found in the smallest of things, in the smallest of beauties. While paramedics scooped up my tiny grandmother after she had fallen in the garden, I noticed and tried to commit to memory the peach-like scent of the orange honey-colored roses behind me. When feeling a hard-to-define homesickness, after living in a country that felt like two tight shoes, I was soothed by noticing migrating geese overhead, the dune grasses swaying in time to the sea, the color of mold on a lemon, the oddly synchronized pedaling of a large group of cyclists as they set off around a peninsula. When you take the time to see and hold these things, you also begin to notice how many other people do not notice them. You find yourself wanting to take people by the arm and point to skies, to horizons, to new leaves on eucalyptus trees. But I cannot blame people for being unseeing when it comes to beauty. As a thing, it has been overexposed and covered in price tags and sold through glossy, untrue photos. And I do wonder a lot if we have been forced to look at one type of beauty for so long that we've completely forgotten how to see it in all its forms. We currently live in a beauty drought. This isn't because the beauty isn't there, but rather because our current definitions of the word are not spacious or welcoming or inclusive, and because beauty has been pressed into strange, stale shapes by people and systems that do not have our best interests at their hearts. They don't have hearts, in a way. The word beauty has left most of us feeling confused, less than, and undeserving, feeling that beauty has left us behind. Beauty has become something to buy, something to own, something to flaunt. But as I was reading just this morning while eating a piece of distinctly average cheesecake, that's the thing about beauty, isn't it? In the end, it belongs to everyone. In the end, it belongs to no one except itself. Susan Johnson. To me, beauty stands alongside love and gravity in holding the world together. From what I have observed, the only one of those we haven't picked apart is gravity. But with love and beauty, we have taken shadowy, winding roads that have, in fact, led us away from love, away from beauty. However impractical it may seem, I am going to try and help you find your way back to beauty. Simply because when we are held together by beauty, there is more room for liberation and less room for fear, more room for gentleness, appreciation, and empathy. It won't be as simple or as instant as refreshing a website that is loading too slowly for your liking. Rather, it will be more like putting a delicate, very broken vase back together. But it is crucially important that we crawl back to beauty however we can, to find new definitions of beauty that allow us to be fully ourselves, powerfully noticing, and expansively human. My hope is that this book is an antidote to fear, to darkness, to dullness, to overwhelm, to lostness, to sleeplessness, and to missing. The definition of beauty, of beautiful, differs between countries, between cultures, and sometimes even between seconds. What society deems beautiful can change from one moment to the next, but for an individual, a particular beauty can sometimes stay forever. Sometimes you will encounter a person, a place, or a thing, and you will call that person, place, or thing beautiful for the rest of time. Part 1. A Brief History of Beauty. How to Explain Beauty. I would like to explain beauty as something a bit like music, a bit like water, a bit like love. It was here before all of us, and it will be here afterward. And during our brief, chaotic appointments with the planet, it does us extraordinary amounts of good to seek it out. I could explain beauty as things that cause you to stop, but also as things that cause you to begin. I could go as far as to say that beauty is the invisible, visible force that makes things make sense, if only for a moment. I could explain it as the things that support the weight of our bodies. It might also be the reason why fish swim upstream, and the reason why we might choose to wake up next to the same person for 60 years. I'd like to explain beauty as corridors before people fill them, as a sunrise seen only by birds. It is the thin lines we draw between ourselves and everything else. The making it make sense, the hindsight, the worthwhile, the looking forward, the acts of kindness, the hoping. It is the rabbit making it across the car-streaked road in time. I would like to explain it as the things that stick to us like small burrs, that call us toward action and fairness. It is the scattering of seeds and the planting of futures. I'd like to explain beauty, but I think that would be a bit like trying to explain love. Here goes nothing. Here goes everything. Next, we'll look at beauty in a variety of ways, thinking about how beauty has become the beauty of today, looking backward and looking forward. I would like for you to have questions more than I would like for you to have answers, but I will try to give you some of those too. I would like for you to get a bit lost, so perhaps check your watch. Perhaps tie yourself to a piece of furniture with string so that you can find your way back easily. I would like for you to whisper some of your secrets in between the pages and for the things you hear to return to you often, on a Tuesday afternoon in July, perhaps. Ancient beauty. I think a lot about what our earliest ancestors found beautiful. Maybe it would have been something from the natural world, like a moonrise. Did somebody decide that the moon was beautiful and we all just went along with it? I don't mind if that's the case, but nevertheless, I'd like to know. Yes, maybe a moonrise, or a low tide, or a red sky at night. Did we always think those things were astonishing? Certainly, we have paid more attention to the dances of the natural world in the times gone by than most of us do now. We used to measure our bodies against seasons and harvests and rain, and now we measure ourselves against schedules and fitted cabinets.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.